أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. So we're talking today about the concept of, you know, I'm trying, I'm struggling, I'm trying to better myself, but I keep messing up. And is this something that's unusual? Is this something that only some people deal with? And what we're really getting at is the heart of being human is messing up. The heart of being human is the fact that we are not perfect. And so much, I think there are so much of the way we teach Islam, the way we understand Islam, that we need to unlearn. One of the things which seems to be prevalent in the way we understand and teach Islam is this concept of perfection, that you're not going to be worthy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. You're not going to be worthy of being considered a religious, good person unless you can be perfect. And this is completely wrong, and it's impossible to ever be perfect, obviously, as a human being. And if you ever do reach that point where you think you're perfect, you've got major issues. You have more issues than if you knew you weren't perfect and you weren't. Because the idea now is you're dealing with arrogance. You're dealing with a deeper and more dangerous disease of self-admiration. If you think that you are perfect, or that, you know, you're pleased with where you're at, or where, or who you, you know, the deeds that you're doing, you're focused on them, and it's making you proud, then we have a more serious problem. And that's where we get into the concept of purification. This is a disease of the heart itself. So what we have to do as we're striving towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we're trying to better ourselves and worship Him better and purify ourselves, we have to be very careful of what it means to be good, of what it means to be a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And ultimately what it means is that I am going to mess up, and I am in desperate need of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the acceptance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And without those things, I'm completely doomed. My deeds can't do anything for me without those things. And that's the problem here, is that we, even as, you know, the religious, so-called religious Muslims, we depend on our deeds. We think that, you know, it's almost like if we were given a choice, you know, do you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And people have, you know, we know a hadith that the man was given a choice. Do you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to, you know, do you want it to be based on your deeds that you enter paradise, or based on the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And, you know, the one who thinks that they have, you know, some good amount of deeds, they might choose their deeds. But even the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that he will not enter Jannah by his deeds, but only by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we need to be very, very careful that as we take this path to Allah, that we don't become pleased with ourselves, we don't become arrogant, and we never think that, no matter, you know, the thing is, no matter what we do of worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to always realize that it's never what He deserves, right? It's always going to be insufficient. And that's why, you know, even when we finish Salah is one of the greatest acts of ibadah. And yet when we finish Salah, we're taught to say astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah immediately after we finish. Astaghfirullah meaning we're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us. We're asking for forgiveness right after we do an act of ibadah. It seems like a contradiction, right? But why are we doing that? Because no matter what we do, no matter what, you know, ibadah we do, it will never be as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deserves. It will never be perfect. It will always be insufficient in some way. And yet, and this is why we don't become hopeless, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is infinitely merciful. So He still accepts these insufficient and incomplete acts of ibadah that we present Him with. But we just have to be, you know, see, this is the thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to accept. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to give. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to forgive and cover and erase our sins. But our job is to keep striving, but at the same time to seek that forgiveness and to seek that acceptance. not to think that I'm getting what I'm getting because I deserve it, but rather we seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to rectify the insufficiencies that we have, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cover up the faults that we have, and we that's all we have. That's all we have is His forgiveness. That's all we have is His mercy. We definitely can't depend on ourselves. We definitely can't depend on our insufficient deeds. We need to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And never lose hope. You are going to go up and down in your faith. You are going to go up and down in your ability to worship Allah. You're going to go up and down. Your iman is never going to be stable. No state in this life is ever stable. And so things are going to go up and down. But never lose hope when you fall down. Never lose hope when you're at a low. Always keep going. Don't give up. And the main thing, you know, even the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he talked about futur, he talked about this dip in iman and in our worship. He said, as long as when you're in futur, you're in that low, in that dip, you are still on the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then you'll be okay. So even when you are in that low, that iman low, or whatever it is that you're going through, even when you're there, as long as you force yourself, even though it's hard at that point, to keep going, and at least you don't compromise the obligatory things, that you don't compromise your salah, you don't compromise these things, and you just keep on going, and eventually you get out of that dip and you go back up. And this is just the sunnah of life. This is the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. يَا أَيُّهُ الْإِنسَانُ إِنَّكَ كَادِحٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ كَدْحًا فَمُلَاقِي. O mankind, you are toiling, ever toiling towards your Lord, but you shall meet Him. So it is this constant toil, it's this constant up and down, it's a struggle. Yes, it is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that it is. But eventually you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we just have to keep begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His mercy and His acceptance and His forgiveness. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from our own selves, our own weaknesses, our own nafs, and from shaitan. And so looking at some of the questions that people have been asking, there's a number of questions that were regarding hijab, for example, asking how can you... for example, convince someone to wear hijab, or how can you get how do you get the courage to wear hijab? And I think that any time we ask a question like this about hijab or otherwise, you know, wearing hijab or not wearing hijab is really it's kind of like a symptom of another issue. Everything that we do externally is a reflection of what we are internally. And so when we look at how we are in our actions or how we are externally, we have to see it as rooted inside. So if I'm having, for example, I'm really struggling with something, that's a sign that there's something internally that I need to work on. So for example, if I'm really, really struggling with giving up something which is displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm having really a lot of trouble, I'm struggling to lower my gaze, for example, or I'm struggling to give up a haram relationship, or I'm struggling to give up a haram income or a job which involves riba or any of these things. If I'm really having a lot of trouble with that, or I'm struggling to wear hijab, I have to look internally and see what is it inside of me that's making this so difficult. And a lot of times what it comes down to is my attachments. A lot of times it comes down to what is it that I love most. And these things that happen in our lives are really just to show us what we need to work on inside. They're a reflection of what we are inside. And therefore it points out those diseases, if you will, internally that need to be addressed. So maybe if I'm having trouble with my salah, or I'm having trouble with hijab, for example, maybe it means that I am too attached to what society thinks of me. Maybe it's because I'm too attached to seeking a certain type of attention, or maybe I don't feel enough value in myself, that I need to be valued. I need to get that certain type of attention in order to feel valued. So again, it can, a lot of times, it can stem from an internal place that we're at. And sometimes, you know, it depends, you know, sometimes it's other things. But what we really have to do is every individual person needs to look internally and see what is the source of this struggle that I'm going through, or, you know, this masiyah, maybe this sin that I'm continuously committing against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so with regards to hijab, for example, you know, the hijab, putting on the hijab is going to become a lot easier when I've built my relationship with Allah and I have a close relationship with Him. You know, love and obedience come hand in hand. The more that you love someone, the more that you want to please them. And when you do love someone and you are in love with someone, everything they tell you, you know, you hear and you obey. You want to do what they want, what they love. You want to make them happy. You want them to be pleased with you. And so the more that we love Allah, the more that we build that strong attachment to Him through the ibadah, through salah, through dhikr, through the remembrance of Allah, then, you know, you don't need to force someone to wear hijab after that. You don't need to convince them to wear hijab after that. As soon as they know this is what the one that I love wants, they do it, you know. And this is, again, it comes as a consequence of love and a consequence of fear, because when you love someone, your greatest fear is to displease them. When you love someone, your greatest fear is for them to cut you off, for them to want to have nothing to do with you, for them to say, you know, like, I don't know you anymore, right? For them to disown you. That's your greatest fear when you love someone. So our fear when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our greatest fear is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would be displeased with us, that Allah would come on the Day of Judgment and say that He doesn't want to speak to us, that He doesn't want to see us, and that there's a veil put between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That should be our greatest fear, and that comes as a consequence of love. That comes as a consequence of building that nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that relationship. So again, I think we go through things sort of from the outside in, and it really should be from the inside out. That the more, you know, for example, when you look at what were the first, Aisha radiallahu anha has said that had the first revelation been not to drink, not to commit fornication, these things, nobody would have been able to do it. No one would have done it. And yet the first revelation to these to the people was about the Day of Judgment, was about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was about La ilaha illallah, was about Tawheed. And because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His wisdom, He knew that these people, that when you come at people with just rules, you come at people with haram and halal, that it's you know, people are going to be like, no way. But if you come at people from the heart, and you come at people from, you tell them about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is Allah, what is the Day of Judgment, what's going to happen to them after they die, and you go at it from internally, those other things become easy. They become a consequence of love. Obedience is a consequence of love. Inshallah, I'm going to go ahead and take another short break, and I'll look over the questions. And when we return, we will continue on the topic of I'm trying, but I keep messing up. We are speaking today about the concept of sin, the concept of imperfections, when we're trying and we keep messing up. And some of the questions, I've taken a look at some of the questions. So one of the questions asks or says, but on the other hand, there are some sisters who don't take their, who don't value their hijab. It's sometimes very sad to see how sisters behave while wearing hijab, how they behave with the opposite sex, having haram relationships. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all. While this is a very valid point, my question is it better if people are doing that and behaving that way without hijab? Does that make the action better? And this is exactly my point, is that the action doesn't become worse because the person is wearing hijab. And that's where we have this idea in our mind where we hold a hijabi to a higher standard than we would a non-hijabi. And that doesn't make any sense, because both are human beings, both are Muslims, both say La ilaha illallah. And so to say that, well, it's worse for a hijabi to do it than a non-hijabi, I don't know of any ruling that says that. That yes, there is obviously the issue of the example for other people, but suppose you're doing it in private. It's not worse for you because you're wearing the hijab. You know, this is what we have to understand, that we all are held accountable. We all, you know, you know, it's like we're all Muslim. You know, if we say La ilaha illallah, we all have the same responsibility. You know, and then there was another comment where someone said that when somebody takes hijab, they're taking on a responsibility. Yes, this is true. They're taking on a responsibility in terms of being an example externally for Islam, and you know, may Allah reward and guide us all. But at the same time, we all have taken on a responsibility. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He has taken a covenant with every human being, أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ, am I not your Lord? And every single human being, every soul said, بَلَا شَهِدْنَا, yes, we bear witness. And so every single person, every human has taken on a responsibility. Are we really fulfilling that responsibility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are we really fulfilling that responsibility to worship Him and Him alone? No, Allah, you know, we're falling short. We all are falling short. And so we have to stop pointing fingers and really look internally. What are we doing? How is it that we can improve? You know, really, we have to realize that the way in which we want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to deal with us is the way we need to deal with other people. If we look at other people and we're so quick to want to, you know, hold them accountable, so quick to criticize, so quick to put them down, you know, that we don't want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to hold us to that, you know. And we're so slow to forgive people, right? You know, oh, they did this to me, or they, you know, and we want to exact, you know, revenge, and we want to like hold on to things. And yet when we turn to Allah, we want Him to be very different with us. Imagine for a moment if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala treated us the way we treat other people. Imagine for a moment if Allah held us accountable for everything that we did and refused to forgive us and wanted to exact, you know, a retribution for every wrong that we did. We would be doomed. And this is the idea that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, and His Messenger teach us that if, you know, have mercy on the people, you know, have mercy on the creation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have mercy on you. This is the lesson, this is the concept, that how we want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be with us is how we should be with the creation. If we want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us and to overlook our many, many faults, we need to be that way towards people. We need to stop being so intolerant and so narrow. And subhanAllah, it is a disease in and of itself that we point to other people, but we don't see the faults in ourselves. And so we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove that veil and to allow us to be among those people who are self-critical, who look internally and who realize that the biggest Fir'aun, the biggest tyrant, is within us, is within our own selves. أَقُولِ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفَرَ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ إِنَّهُ.